I want you to turn in your Bibles to 1 John chapter 1. 1 John chapter 1. We have completed our study of the Gospel of John. Now we're moving into John's three letters, 1st, 2nd, and 3rd John. And you're going to find these immensely practical books, how to live out the Christian life. But we're going to be looking at verses 1 through 4. And as you're turning, let's have a moment as we gather our thoughts and have a prayer before our Lord. Our gracious Heavenly Father, we come here today and we are so thankful for the love you show us through your Son, Jesus Christ. God, I am very much aware, having been at our convention, reading the news, hearing the news, just walking around our communities, that we are a world that doesn't have a real good grasp on who Jesus is. And yet, we so desperately not only need to know who he is, not only need to embrace him in our hearts for eternal life, but for those of us that know him, we need to share him. Lord, the trajectory of our nation and our world is not a good one. We pray for revival. We pray with hope. But I also pray that you will return soon. And so, Lord, as we come today and we study your word, help us to grab hold of the essence of our Christ, of who he is and what he is to us. And let us not be selfish and hold him just to ourselves, but let us share him with others. Because as we're about to hear, there are a lot of people that have some very weird views of who our Jesus is.
White guy with a beard?
Oh my God, you are! You're Jesus Christ!
He died for our sins so that we could be saved. And in my religion, it means we can f*** up as much as we want, and as long as we are truly sorry, then we're saved.
A white guy, looks like he's from the 60s.
A reason to believe and to continue on in your life and your journey.
Not that blonde-haired dude that they show in all those pictures.
I think Jesus was just a story made up by someone. Could have been probably a real person. It's something special, but not like the story says.
I'm actually glad you're all here tonight. I want to tell you that one of you will betray me.
Nah, just kidding.
Ah, he's doing that thing he did in his storybook.
Jesus, a friend of mine from Puerto Rico.
I don't know. I don't know Jesus very well, so.
Jesus? Like Jesus? The Son of God?
Jesus is my Lord and Savior. Definitely not the guy who cuts my lawn.
Dear tiny infant Jesus.
Hey, you know, sweetie, Jesus did grow up. You don't always have to call him baby. It's a bit odd and off-putting to pray to a baby.
Well, look, I like the Christmas Jesus best, and I'm saying grace.
Yes, there's definitely something special about Jesus. The same things that are special about me and you and, well, everybody.
Definitely good morals and beliefs, and possibly had some special gift.
Jesus. Jesus! And his best pal, Peter! Wow!
Who do you say Jesus is?
He's really important. His birthday's coming up.
People, believe in Jesus. He is your savior. He is number one.
Everyone is giddy with anticipation for Jesus to come out because, as we all know, if Jesus comes out of his house and is not scared by his shadow, it means the next 1,000 years will be full of peace and love.
He was just really chill. I think he even smoked some pot, so I love Jesus even more.
He seems like a kind of Gandhi type guy.
Some superpower, I just don't know. I believe in him, so.
He was Jewish.
Look, I think he's inspiring for a lot of people, so that's really cool to me.
God bless him.
A make-believe story that's got blown out of proportion.
Some of what you see and hear bother you, offend you. You know, I showed this provocative video for a reason, and it was published for a reason. You know, sometimes as Christians, we can live in a spiritual cocoon or a little bubble, if you will. We talk to people and we tell them about Jesus, and they say, oh, I know Jesus. But as you can see, they really don't. Not really. Most of the people in this world either have no idea who the real Jesus is, or they have just flat out rejected him. You see, who is Jesus? It really is an important question, but why? You see, we live in a time where people claim to be Christian, but they really don't know what the Bible teaches. There are churches and faiths that call themselves Christian, but either they do not believe that the Bible is true at all, or that it is subject to change with the times, that they call it, in essence, a living book, but how they define living is not how you and I would define it. But it is a really old book, right? But if we cannot know Jesus Christ from the Bible, how do we know him? How do we know him? You know, people refer to Jesus by name, and they often have little or no clue who he really is, what he really did, or what he calls us to. And of course, we live in an era that is increasingly resistant or questioning anything that calls itself absolute truth. Don't tell me that's true. I don't need to hear it from you because I have my own truth. But not to be Captain Obvious, sadly, I really do think this needs to be said. Christianity is Christianity because of Jesus Christ. Now, probably 100 years ago, if I had made that statement, people would have looked at me and gone, well, yeah, or maybe not that way. I don't think they talked like that back then. But at any rate, but you know, our faith, our beliefs are ultimately valid and true only if there really was a real historical Christ who is the incarnation of God, born of a virgin, taught, was crucified, was buried, was rose again the third day, is still alive, and someday will return. That is Christianity. Call it what you will. If that is not part of what Christianity is, then their stuff is not Christianity. You know, at East Shore Baptist Church, we view the entirety of Scripture as truth. We do that, but what should we make? What should we make of a Christianity? And think about this for a moment. What should we make about a Christianity that is subject to the whims and imagination and fanciful interpretations of its teachers and followers? Because they are out there. How can something be true when it changes with the prevailing attitudes of man and the times? Can your Jesus really be true if you have rejected or ignore the very source in which he is revealed? The Scriptures. God's Word, where God has revealed himself to man. And how can one be confident of a home in heaven if truth is only relative to the individual? I'm going to heaven. Why? Because I believe it. Well, what do you believe? And what standard then is the hope of heaven measured? And again, at East Shore Baptist Church, we view the Scripture, the entirety of the Word of God, as truth, as the very standard of our faith and practice, and the very revelation of Jesus Christ. We have a hope of heaven because we have hope in a genuine biblical Christ. Now, if you have listened intently to the study we just completed through the Gospel of John, or if you have spent any time reading the Bible, you would probably pick up on the fact that Jesus and the writers of the New Testament in particular make some amazing claims about Jesus Christ. Amazing. And they talk about his person, they talk about his work, and sometimes I really think some of us maybe scratch our heads, whether we realize it or not, and go, really? Did that really happen? But you see, what we need to do is we need to come to a conclusion. Much as C.S. Lewis wrote in his book, Mere Christianity, we have really four options as to who Jesus is. He was a liar. He was a lunatic. He was a legend. Or he really was Lord. He really is Lord. You know, who has not heard about the shooting at an African-American church in Charleston, South Carolina. We have our Supreme Court ready to rule on whether or not marriage is between a man or a woman, or it is more than that. When we were in Columbus, I had an opportunity to go to the school I graduated from, and almost right across the street from the dormitory I lived in for a couple of years, there is a Baptist church. And on the right-hand corner, on the bottom of that sign, was a rainbow flag. Now, if you don't know what that is, come talk to me afterwards. But it was a Baptist church. And I think sometimes we want to look up and go, what is going on here? What is happening? How did this come about? But it might help to know that, as a man named Solomon once wrote in Ecclesiastes 1:9, he said, there is really nothing new under the sun. You see, what's fascinating in this book that we're about to read, John, the Apostle John, lived in a time that, though we might say they dressed differently, they talked differently, there was some different stuff, it really wasn't that different morally, ethically, and at the end of the day, socially. He was dealing with a lot of the same issues we deal with, though in different form, as we are today. And so he wrote this letter we are beginning to study in order to address some of these things. Now, he starts with Jesus Christ. He starts with Christ. Why? Because John knew, and we better get it, that if we don't get Jesus Christ right, nothing else really matters. Nothing else really matters. It doesn't make a difference. And as he quoted Jesus saying in John 14:6, Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no man comes unto the Father but by me. Well, let's take a look first at some of the background of this wonderful letter. Along with Hebrews, 1 John does not identify its author. It has been historically and traditionally ascribed to the Apostle John. And from the evidence of this epistle, or letter, as it would also be known as, including its content, style, and tone of authority, tradition has held that it was written by the Apostle John. It was attested to by many of the early church fathers to have been written by the Apostle John. And as such, we really have no good reason to doubt that it was written by John. Now, while the exact dating of this epistle is difficult, most biblical scholars seem to date it sometimes towards the latter part of the first century, or roughly between 80 and 95 AD. It is also likely to have been written from Ephesus to the churches of Asia Minor, over which John exercised apostolic authority, but we can't really be absolutely certain of that. At this time, John would have been greatly advanced in age and would have been the sole remaining apostolic survivor who had intimate eyewitness association with Jesus throughout his earthly ministry, his death and his resurrection and his ascension. Now, as the last remaining apostle, John's testimony was highly authoritative among the churches. It stands to reason. He's the last. He's it. Now, in his letter, in the Gospel of John, John tells us, let me back up. In the Gospel of John, what John does, he tells the purpose of his letter, and he says, and truly Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are written in this book, or not written in this book, but these were written that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that believing you may have life in his name. So what he's doing in his gospel is he's writing to share Christ, to lead people to Christ. In 1 John, however, he is actually writing to believers. You'll see in a number of passages, including chapter 2, verse 7, and chapter 5, verse 13, he's writing to brethren. He's writing to his beloved. He's writing to believers. That's his primary audience. But what's interesting about that is the why. And we'll get to that in a moment. But it's predicted years before by the Apostle Paul in Acts chapter 20, verses 38 through 31. False teachers, wolves in sheep's clothing, both within and without, have begun to affect and infect the church. And they've been doing it with false doctrine, with false teaching, twisting and perverting the fundamentals or the fundamental apostolic teaching, the fundamentals of our faith, if you will. While there were numerous variations, most of these erroneous doctrines came to be known or referred to as Gnosticism, the most dangerous of the heresies, antinomianism, or perfectionism. And one of John's principal purposes in his letter is to combat these doctrines. These are what were largely prevalent in this first century, or the latter part of it. Now, first, let's look at the word Gnosticism, which comes from the Greek word, which means knowledge. This was it was influenced by philosophers such as Plato, advocated a dualism, asserting the matter was inherently evil and spirit was good. Because of this, teachers of this dangerous philosophy would attribute some deity to Jesus Christ, but would deny his true humanity to preserve him from evil. It's interesting. Some denied that Christ's physical body was real, but that it only seemed to be real. In other words, they were denying the physical Christ. Another version contended that Christ's spirit descended upon the physical Jesus at his baptism, but left at his crucifixion. But Gnosticism, all in all, actually claimed an elevated knowledge, a higher truth known only to the initiated, which was higher even than Scripture. The Gnostic belief that matter is evil and only spirit was good led to the idea that either the body should be treated harshly, a form of asceticism, or sin committed in the body had no connection or effect in one's spirit. Here's what you can take away from Gnosticism, that we can think and intellectualize our way into the kingdom of God. Does anyone have any idea what that looks like today? Step foot on any of our major universities, any of our little universities, and you will probably find a form of modern day Gnosticism. Antinomianism, which was under the covenant of grace, nothing is required but to believe. It was interesting. They contended that believers, that you could, in other words, it didn't matter how you lived after you were saved, they literally disregarded God's law. You didn't have to obey God's law. Is that once you came to a faith, you could do whatever you want. By the way, we have those churches today too. And then we have perfectionism, which is the sin nature is eradicated at conversion. Well, no, it isn't. Not really. You know, the penalty for sin is eradicated, but what happens is we still have a sin nature within us. And so he is going to combat these. Now, while these were closely related to each other, John, under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit and with unquestionable apostolic authority, sent this letter to stem the spreading plague of false doctrine. The overarching theme of 1 John is a recall to the fundamentals of the faith, or back to the basics of Christianity, as we would term it today. And while the Gospel of John was written that we might have eternal life, 1 John was written that we might know that we have eternal life, which we will see in chapter 5, verse 13. What John is trying to do is help us as Christians to understand what it means to be a believer and to know that we are a believer, that we have something that we can hang on to, that we can believe in. He teaches in loving pastoral tones, but he presents the fundamentals of Christianity in unmistakable, absolute, simple and clear, not relative terms. John, as you will see as we continue through this letter, he is an in-your-face kind of teacher, and he doesn't pull punches. Now, the first four verses of 1 John serve as an introduction or prologue to this letter. But what's also interesting, and we're focusing on this today, this is an important introduction. Again, he starts with Christ. But what's also interesting about John's style is, unlike the Apostle Paul, who in most of his letters started with some nice pleasantries and kind of like some real sweet things, how you doing, I'm praying for you. John doesn't do that. He dives right in to what he has to say. So let's begin at verse 1. That which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we have looked upon, and our hands have handled, concerning the word of life. The life was manifested, and we have seen and bear witness and declare to you that eternal life which was with the Father and was manifested to us. That which we have seen and heard, we declare to you, that you may also have fellowship with us. And truly, our fellowship is with the Father and His Son, Jesus Christ. And these things we write to you, that your joy may be full. Now, the first thing we're going to look at is the certainty of the word of life. The certainty of the word of life. That which was from the beginning. Now, this could allude back to Genesis chapter 1, verse 1, in the beginning God. But more to the point, I believe what John is going after, he's talking about the person and the gospel message that man is saved through Christ and Christ alone. He's talking about Jesus, and he's talking about his message. It does not change. That's the thing we really need to grab hold of. The gospel does not change. You know, the amazing thing, people get saved the same way today they would if they heard the Apostle John give a gospel invitation. It doesn't change. And over the centuries, people have sought to change the gospel message, and they still do, that we can be good enough or that there's another way or many ways or no way. But the gospel, the true gospel, is that Jesus Christ died for our sins, and we must repent of our sin and believe. Believe God and believe this word that truly is alive, but it's not subject to the change our culture likes to think it does. Now, to those who offer a gospel other than that presented by Christ and his apostles, Paul had something to say about this, which is really interesting. He says, I am astonished that you are so quickly deserting the one who called you by the grace of Christ and are turning to a different gospel, which is really no gospel at all. Evidently, some people are throwing you into confusion and are trying to pervert the gospel of Christ. But even if we or an angel from heaven should preach a gospel other than the one we preach to you, let him be eternally condemned. Let him be accursed. As we have already said, so now I say again, if anybody's preaching to you a gospel other than that what you accepted, let him be eternally condemned. There is no other gospel. There is none. And then let's go back again. He says, that which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we have looked upon and our hands have handled concerning the word of life, the life was manifested, and we have seen and bear witness and declare to you that eternal life, which is with the Father and was manifested to us. Again, John was an apostolic witness to the earthly ministry, death, burial, resurrection, and ascension of Jesus Christ. Now, unlike the false teachers, though, who had never seen or known Jesus Christ, he did. He knew Christ intimately. And over again, using numerous repetitions, John emphasizes the authority of his own personal witness. You guys are flapping your jaws. I knew him. I know him. The word of life, again, refers not just to the person of Jesus Christ, but more to the point, the truth and the proclamation of his gospel. It's referring to both. In fact, you can't separate Christ from his gospel. You know, Jesus is the word. He's the living word. And what happened was Gnosticism questioned the truth of Jesus Christ. It seemed to ascribe some deity to Jesus, but denied his humanity. But then people questioned the truth of Christ today. Again, that video I showed you wasn't just to tick you off. It was to help you understand how people see Jesus today. But you see, Jesus is divine. He is God. Jesus himself declared before Abraham was, I am. He said, the Father and I are one. And he said, the one who has seen me has seen the Father. Again, I'm pulling from the Gospel of John because John has a point to make. Jesus is God, but Jesus is also human. which is also fascinating. See, throughout the gospel and this letter, John presents a rigorous case for the humanity of Jesus Christ. He saw, he handled, he ate, he talked with him, he did life beside Jesus Christ. What is at stake, and what John clearly is addressing, is the incarnation of Jesus Christ. That Jesus Christ is fully God and fully man, without conflict. He's not a myth. He was the real deal. He's not some disembodied spirit. He's not some symbol of our faith. In essence, John begins both his first letter and his gospel with the eternal Christ, who is also man. Listen to these words from John chapter 1, verse 1 and verse 14. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And we beheld his glory, the glory is of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. The Word became flesh, and we beheld him. Many are willing to accept a Jesus who is a creature of their own imagination or longing, a Jesus who is but a spiritual entity. We're okay with a Jesus who makes no demands, who doesn't judge, and well, minds his own business. He doesn't get into yours. But to believe in a biblical incarnational Jesus, that is another matter altogether. John Piper, in his book Eternal Life, puts it this way. He says, I don't think it is so much the mystery of a divine and human nature in one person that causes most people to stumble over the doctrine of the incarnation. The stumbling block is that if this doctrine is true, every single person in the world must obey this one particular Jewish man. Everything he says is law. Everything he did is perfect. And the particularity of his work and word flow out into history in a form of a particular inspired book, written in the particular languages of the Greek and the Hebrew, that claims the universal authority over every other book that has ever been written. And may I add, that has ever will be written. This is a stumbling block of the incarnation. When God becomes a man, he strips away every pretense of man to be God. We can no longer do our own thing. We must do what this one Jewish man wants us to do. We can no longer pose as self-sufficient because this one Jewish man says we are all sick with sin and must come to him for healing. We can no longer depend on our own wisdom to find life because this one Jewish man who lived for 30 obscure years in a little country in the Middle East says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. But there are many who don't like that Jesus. And so they make him up. Well, we need to have a passion to share the word of life. We need to have a passion to share the word of life because this is what John is talking about next. You know, last summer, when Gene and I traveled to Maine, we actually started in New Hampshire, and we tried something we had never done before. We got on Segways and toured the city. Since then, we have been totally jazzed about riding Segways, so much so, we've actually had a couple of trips. You'll actually notice some of the people in these pictures. They shall remain nameless, though they're sitting right in front of me over here and over here. But we loved riding Segways. They are fun. I know, to me, something that shouldn't do what it does and you're doing it is kind of cool. You know what I'm saying? So we love to share about it. We love to talk about it. And if any of you guys want to go Segwaying, you just come talk to me. I might be up for it. But at any rate, the Apostle John spent three or more years with Jesus Christ. The impact on his life in that time was likely far more than he could put into words or his writing. John's life was so radically changed. It was so impacted by Christ that he forsook all he was, all he knew, and all he could have been, at least from the world standards, to share the gospel of Jesus Christ to the world around him. No matter the suffering, persecution, or opposition, John was compelled to share the word of life. John was a true follower of Jesus Christ. And he says in verse 3, that which we have seen and heard, we declare to you that you may have fellowship with us, and truly our fellowship is with the Father and with the Son, Jesus Christ. Let's go to fellowship with us. This is not referring to social relations per se. Instead, it is equating fellowship with salvation. One cannot have genuine salvation. Cannot have genuine salvation, eternal life, or fellowship with God apart from a proper view of Jesus Christ. You can wish and desire all you want to go to heaven, but if you don't have a proper view of Jesus Christ, you will have no fellowship with God. You will have no eternal home. Again, Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no man comes to the Father but by me. I think with someone who made that statement, I want to know who he is. In Acts chapter 4, verse 12, or 10 through 12, it says, there's no other name under heaven and on earth by which man can be saved. What's more, there can be no genuine fellowship with other believers apart from saving faith and a proper view of Christ and his word. You can't do it. We are not going to have fellowship, true fellowship among ourselves, without a proper view of Jesus Christ and his word. That's why we read in 2 Corinthians 6:14, do not be unequally yoked together with unbelievers, for what fellowship is righteousness with lawlessness? And what communion has light with darkness? And by the way, I could go and I could plug this into almost every social relationship, intimate social relationship we have today. I can't tell you how many times I've talked to a believer and an unbeliever who are looking to get married. And by the way, whether it's said or it's thought, here's the thing. I will change him or I will change her. No, you won't. Only God will do that. It is a fool's errand to do that. Partnerships. I've encountered people who are dedicated believers who partner with an unbeliever. And they wonder why that doesn't work out. They don't have the same ethics nor morality that you do. Now, I hope you have friends with unbelievers. I hope you have relationships with people that don't know Jesus Christ, that you're loving on them and ministering to them with the hope and prayer that someday you can lead them to a saving faith in Jesus Christ. But that better not be the kind of friendship, it better not be the kind of intimate relationship that you have with other believers. You know, and I've said this before and I'll say it again, you have more in common with believers of all stripes and all colors around the world than you do your own blood family. Amen. And you need to grab hold of that reality. I have more in common with a Nigerian who is a believer in the Lord Jesus Christ, or a Ukrainian, or a Taiwanese who loves and is passionately following Jesus Christ than I do my own family who does not know him. Fascinating. That which we have seen and heard, we declare to you. John saw him. John walked with him. And it's like John says, there's no way I could be silent. Has God changed you? Has God moved in your heart? Folks, I got to tell you something. I'm going to be very transparent and candid for a moment here. I have struggled for years because most of my relationships, most of my contacts have been with, I'm not using this term badly, church people, you, people I know who are believers, other pastors. I hang out with church people. And just the other day, I shadowed Tom when he was at Community General Hospital. I only hung with him for an hour. We visited four people. Four times Tom had the opportunity to share the gospel of Jesus Christ. Gene and I, so I'm declaring this, so we got to do it. I understand Tom did last week too. We are going to be volunteering at Community General Hospital. Now, it's going to take me away from the church. It's going to take me away maybe from a phone conversation with you one day. But let me tell you, I need to do this. We need to do this. Because we need to be around people that don't know Jesus Christ to tell them about his love and tell them about his mercy and tell them how they can have a relationship with him. That you also may have fellowship with us, and truly our fellowship is with the Father and with the Son, Jesus Christ. John is inviting people to join the family of God. We are not a closed family, beloved. You know, I know many of you might express, oh, you know, I love our church just the size it is and the way it is. And I get that. I understand that. I mean, honestly, people come, well, I had to ask a couple of their names this morning because I need to remember and I need to write it down so I can be praying effectively for them. But please hear me. Our church needs to be as big as God wants it to be, not as big as we want it to be. We are not a closed unit. We are not a closed family. God is always at work around us, and we need to get in on what He's doing. And then there is the joy of the Word of Life, the joy of the Word of Life. In verse 4, you know, when I attended college at Ohio State University, and by the way, it was really cool being back on campus. Sunday afternoon after church, Gary and Jean and I went on campus. I hadn't been there since December of 1980. It was right after I graduated, before I moved to Florida. And it was really neat. I was showing Jean the dormitory I lived in, the apartment building I lived in. And I was standing on the oval looking at the library. The oval is a big area that was originally part of the oldest part of the campus. And I'm looking down at the oval, not back at High Street, which is the main drag through Columbus, but I'm looking towards the library. And I'm thinking, this could be 1980. it was like I just stepped back in time. It was so cool. And then Allie over there is thinking about going. Be in prayer for her, okay? And be especially in prayer for Mom and Dad. But I heard about the library being so cool, so we walked into the library, and it doesn't look anything like it did when I was going there. But it was just really cool. But back to my story. When I was going to Ohio State University, I had for a time a roommate who taught me a lot about life. I won't tell you his name, but he was a very interesting guy. I met him in his sophomore year. It would have been technically my sophomore year as well. But when I knew him, he was an interesting guy. He was very smart. He was in advanced studies when he came to Ohio State. But he wasn't just very smart. He wasn't just incredibly bright. He also was a good athlete. He came not only on an academic scholarship, but he came on an athletic scholarship. Unfortunately, like so many young people that go to our secular universities today, he fell into, how shall I say, the social scene of drinking and parties. And he drank and he partied and he drank some more and partied some more. And then he got into doing pot, and pot led to pills, and pills led to more parties and more pot and more pills and more this, that, and the other. Until eventually, in our second quarter, at least together, he was sent packing. He was dismissed from the university. I don't know whatever became of him, but I prayed, I thought about him and prayed for him over the years, and I wonder whatever became of him, because here was a bright, promising young man, the world at his fingertips, and he threw it all away. You see, what he deemed fun, exciting, pleasurable was academically and physically destroying him, his future and his health. You know, he was a living testimony that, how shall I say, there's a way that seems right unto a man, but the end thereof is the way of death. But I get it. You see, I never had a problem with the pills or the marijuana or the drinking. That wasn't my thing, but I did enough stuff that was detrimental to me. I had plenty of things that were going on that were kind of leading to my death, if you will. I look back now and I wonder, why couldn't I see it? I mean, what was I thinking? Well, we all know the answer to that. You weren't, and I wasn't. I often wonder how I could have been so foolish, but can I also be transparent with you? I still wrestle with many of those same demons even today. They haven't left me. They're a little different, but they're still there. John discovered in Christ the source of true joy. Not that every day for him would be a picnic or a good time, but that genuine faith in the genuine Christ provided him with a genuine sense of joy. That's what he got. I mean, if you read some of the history of John, You know, the man was boiled in hot oil and he survived. He was exiled to the island of Patmos, which people, I've never been to, but I think, Stan, Linda, you've been there. And it's a pretty desolate place, and probably was back then too. And, you know, they were persecuted, they were hunted. It was not an easy life. And yet John talks about joy, because joy is not always what we feel, is what we experience in Christ. He says, "In these things we write unto you, that your joy may be full." And the point John is making here, and he's going to be making throughout his letter, is that there can be no genuine joy apart from fellowship with God. You will not know joy. You may have fleeting moments of happiness, but you won't know true joy. In the life of a believer, sin doesn't take away our salvation, but it does rob us of our true joy. And again, we need to grab hold of this. We can be happy for periods of time. And we can be really happy for periods of time. But happiness comes and goes. What remains for the believer who follows and loves Christ is joy. You know, I've been around enough believers in this world who have experienced intense persecution to know what joy really is. "If you keep my commandments," said Jesus, "you will abide in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. These things I have spoken to you, that my joy may remain in you, and that your joy may be full." Jesus connects his presence in our hearts and the reality of our lives with joy. You know, when I was young, I remember having an opportunity to swing at a piñata. If any of you have ever seen America's Funniest Home Videos, you know those things are dangerous. They should be outlawed. I am just saying. You know, they're crazy. I mean, you take this stick and they blindfold you and you start swinging at this thing, hoping to hit it and knock the good stuff out. You know, candy, toys, whatever. And it's just nuts. I mean, and they can be downright dangerous, because if they swing you around, I mean, everyone's a target. You know what I'm saying? You got to run for your life. But I am of the humble opinion that life without a true Christ, life without the biblical Jesus, is very much, if you will, metaphorically speaking, a piñata game. You see, we're trying to swing at life. We think we know where it is, but we usually miss. We think we found the good stuff, but we just found something we shouldn't have stepped in. You know, we think we struck gold, but what we did, we struck someone we love. Life without Christ is like a piñata game. You think it's full of reward and pleasure, but you can end up hurting yourself and others. And we almost always do. But what are you looking for in life? Are you looking for love? Are you looking for happiness? Are you looking for joy, faith, peace, hope, security? I get that, because I am too. But have you ever noticed that people often have very different notions of what those things look like? You talk about love, but for some, it's really different looking. And peace, it can be rather strange. And security. And I think there are times we wonder, okay, is there a standard for this stuff? I mean, is this just whatever? I mean, are these things defined by us? I mean, do we know love because of how we know love? Or is there some standard? Well, beloved, there's good news. There is a standard. It's called the Word of God. There is a standard. And you see, a relationship with Jesus Christ helps us to know what that is and what it looks like. Because we won't know it apart from Him. We'll see the fraud. We'll see the good, but we won't see the best. We'll see the fake. We'll see the glossy, shiny bauble that we go and have appraised and find out it's worthless. Having settled faith in the true, the biblical Christ, not only brings with it access to these things called love, joy, peace, and joy and security and stuff, but it helps you to grasp what they really mean. Again, what they really look like. And again, it's more often not very, very different from what the world defines it as. The word of life brings certainty in the midst of a relative world. It, or how shall I say, Jesus, it gives you something solid to stand on when the sands and tides of human experience and human opinions and human science and human morals and human standards shift with the seasons of time. Do you know the genuine Christ? It really matters. It really, really, really matters. Let me close with these verses. The Apostle Paul wrote these. He goes, "What then? If some did not believe, their unbelief will not nullify the faithfulness of God, will it? May it never be. God forbid. Rather, let God be found true, though every man be found a liar. As it is written, that you may be justified in your words and prevail when you are judged." Here's the thing you need to grasp. There is not a single person on the face of this planet that is walking today that is incapable of lying. Only God is consistently true. Only God. I hope you know him. We're going to close in a word of prayer, but I want to share with you as we move into our time of invitation and response. At the close of our service, we're going to bring Rich and Deidre up, and we are going to lay hands and pray over them. Rich is dealing with small cell cancer, and you know, it matters that he knows the biblical Christ. It really matters. And they're both going to have to hang on to him very tightly. Let's pray. Heavenly Father God, as we come to you today and we humbly bow ourselves before you, we need to excise from our minds and our hearts our own opinions about you. And we need to settle on what you have revealed. We need to understand that there is nothing about you that is not in accord with the Word of God. Your Word is the measure by which we know you. It is the gold standard by which we experience you. Everything that we know about you must be taken back to the Word of God, because you will not be contradicted in your word. I know too many people that come to me and they talk about a Jesus that is not in accordance with your word. And God, it's not for me to be angry. It's for me to weep. Because in all probability, they do not have a relationship with you. And how horrific to stand before you one day, when all of us will stand before you when this life is over, thinking we have a home in heaven, only to hear these words: "Depart from me, I never knew you." Oh God, may it never be. May we know you, may we passionately follow you, may we surrender our lives to you. And God, if there is one here that does not know you as Savior and Lord, I pray to you, O Lord, that before they leave this sanctuary today, they will pull someone aside. They will come to me and say, "I want to know. I want to be sure. I want to be certain." We cannot presume upon tomorrow. We cannot know for certain. Lord, we could be sitting in a church. We could be sitting in a prayer meeting. And some person with a warped, twisted mind can pull out a gun and gun us down. We just don't know. And so, Lord, our altar is open for prayer. Our altar is open. If there is a desire for being baptized, if there is a desire to come and be a part of this church, we want to be here with open hands. But more importantly, with an open Bible. And so that we may help all to know you, the Word of life, your Word. In Jesus' name I humbly pray. Amen.